Good evening. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. Wow, what a crowd. Who's ready to win an election? I would like to welcome all of you here tonight, and I would like to ask you to please welcome Minnesota's next governor, Dr. Scott Jensen.
You're here because a long time ago, Teddy Roosevelt talked about the cheap seats, and he talked about getting in the arena, getting bruised and bloodied and bullied. And you're saying Minnesota's in a place that we're going to do whatever it takes because this can't go on. We've had enough. And that's why my wife and I are here, because we're with you all the way. Esther 4:14 says, have you considered you're in the position you're in for such a time as this? Think about that. 2 years ago, none of us could have dreamt that Minnesota, America, or the world would be in the place we're in. We're seeing hundreds of thousands of people responding and demonstrating in France, in Germany, in England, in America. And then we have this incredible convoy that says, a bunch of Canadians, they say, we're doing it. We're done. But let's remember, the Canadian convoy said we're done, and now we've got the CDC saying it's done. But if you look at the numbers, from a year ago to now, we have double the cases, new cases today than we did a year ago. We have double the deaths. We have more hospitalizations now. So tell me where that science is. Tell me where the science is that says it's all over. Do you know what it is? This is political. This has been the CDC. Well, did you see today we had the CDC director Walensky saying, well, gee whiz, Pfizer didn't tell us that their vaccine might not work against the variants. And the Pfizer saying, well, we're going to give you the data so you can look it over, but we're not going to give it to you for 5 to 9 years. And then we've got basically the Surgeon General federally saying, we've got to go on a manhunt. We've got to go get the people that have been spreading misinformation. Well, we don't need a manhunt. All you have to do is go to the CDC and you'll find most of them. And then we've got my new acquaintance, Joe Latipo, the Surgeon General for Florida. And he comes out and says, you know what? We're not recommending the vaccine for kids. We're going to let parents make the choice because this matters. I've got to tell you, I thought that I was supposed to speak tonight for 17 minutes, and my general consultant just told me, you've got 3 minutes, and I said, I'll compromise. So I've got 8. But where is my wife? Mary, would you stand up? People ask me, they say, are you sure you want to be governor? I look them straight in the eye and I say, I never said I wanted to be governor. I feel compelled by the words of Esther 4:14 for such a time as this. Honestly, on our bucket list, this wasn't one of the items. We would rather have jumped out of an airplane to see if the parachute would open. I met Mary on a bus a long time ago. She was on a bus and I was looking for a seat, and I finally found a seat next to her and I said, is that open? She said, yes. I sat down, looked straight ahead. I was trained appropriately by my Norwegian mother. I know how to build relationships. You'll stare straight ahead. After 15 seconds were over, I sort of felt like I knew her, so I glanced over at her, and right in front of her chest, she was holding on to an Erlenmeyer flask which is an interesting chemical flask, fat on the bottom, skinnies at the top. But what I was amazed about by this flask was that she had encompassed the whole thing in aluminum foil. She caught me looking at her flask. That's uncomfortable. What could a Norwegian say? I looked at her and I said, "Are you trying to oxidize an aldehyde into a ketone?" She said, "Yes." She told me 2 years later when I asked her to marry me, she said, "I knew you were the one." And I am absolutely certain, when I go and meet the good Lord on the other side of this threshold, I'm going to ask him, did anybody else ever in the history of mankind pick up a hot chick like Mary with that line, "Are you trying to oxidize an aldehyde into a ketone?" But let's flip through the issues real fast. You're hearing a lot of conservative candidates say a lot of the same things, so I'm not going to bore you with them. But I'm going to tell you this. This campaign, this election, is not just about the issues. This is about leadership. And when it comes to leadership, you know what bad leadership looks like. It looks like gridlock. It looks like the blame game. It looks like backroom deals. It looks like omnibus bills. It looks like cowardice. It frankly looks like the Lion and the Wizard of Oz. And that's not what we're about. This team, we said at the beginning, and Mary and I laid this out, we are going to speak truth to power, even if it means my license goes away. And it's not going to mean that, because I'm going to win. We're going to respect. We're going to respect every Minnesotan, and we are going to resist groupthink. And when it comes push to shove, we're not going to flinch. I'm going to have the privilege in a few minutes to, if you will, introduce a video about a man who doesn't flinch. And that's what our campaign is about. We're not going to flinch. If you remember the words, we the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, and then you go down a few lines and it says, and secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and our posterity. That's why you're so motivated, because you know that what we want to leave to the generations to come is in danger. When Ronald Reagan said in the 1980s that freedom is only one generation away from extinction, we thought those were pretty fancy words, but we never thought we would be living it. But we're living it, and that's why you're here. Thank you for coming. You're going to meet this guy tonight. I think you're going to like him. I did the fourth time I met him, I really thought, yeah, he's okay. Yeah, okay. But you're going to meet this guy, and what you're going to realize is that he's a real person. He's not interested in having some scripted conversation that goes perfectly. We just did a TV interview. We're going to disagree. I disagree with my wife with some frequency, and then she tells me what to think, and then I straighten up. But we're going to have a real conversation with Minnesota, because this isn't about scripting. Enough of the political jargon, enough of the politicizing. We know that we have to resecure safety in the streets. We know that we have to elevate our Second Amendment rights in order for that to happen. We know that Minnesota's got a spending problem, and we should have a serious discussion, not just about getting rid of Social Security taxation, but we should have a discussion about how could Minnesota look if we didn't have a personal income tax? Why can't we have that discussion? There's nobody better to identify how their child will succeed than a parent. So let's stop funding broken institutions, let's start giving parents choices, and let's start plugging our kids into a menu where they'll succeed. And just briefly, I know many of you are very concerned about what's happened to elections. We need to have a forensic audit of the 2020 election. We know that. We know that. But what we really need is we need to win this election by 10%. So regardless of what shenanigans go on, we are going to be the victors in November. That's what has to happen. And speaking of being a victor, I want you to watch a video. And I want you to watch it carefully. In fact, if we don't think you've watched it carefully enough, we're probably going to play it twice. This really matters, because in this video, what you're going to see is you're going to see the absolute tenor of the campaign for the next 8 months. It's going to be about winning. It's going to be about respect. People have asked me, who did you want for a lieutenant governor? And I said, well, I want someone with character, because you can't teach character. And I wanted someone who had a skill set that would intersect with mine, so that they would lead and they would help me be better. And quite frankly, it's not that difficult to find people smarter than me, so we'll have no trouble there. But I also wanted someone with a fierce determination, a determination to win on the field, in the classroom, in the business office, wherever. Folks, this election is all about electability. How do we expand our base? How do we get moderates and independents to say yes? We want to vote for those people that say no to critical race theory, that say yes to a foundational education. We want to vote for a winner. We think Minnesota can do so much better. And if you want to know just how much better Minnesota can get, let's turn our attention to the video. Thank you so much.
Tim Walz claims to be one hell of a football coach. 2 years ago, he said it was halftime in Minnesota. Today, time is running out in the fourth quarter, and under Tim Walz's lack of leadership, we're losing badly. The team he's put on the field has been a disaster for Minnesota. His lockdowns destroyed small business and did untold damage to our economy. His political pandering has moved the goalposts and prolonged the pandemic. He is soaking our seniors with taxes. His inflationary economy is leaving most of us behind. He let lawlessness and violent crime get out of control. And he gave in to the teachers' union to hold our kids down. We need to take back the field, but we can't do it alone. We need a teammate who isn't afraid to hit back. We're gonna fight for students over broken institutions and empower parents to make the best decisions for their kids. We'll make our state safe again and support the first responders who put it all on the line. We're gonna lead Minnesota into a future that brings people here instead of sending them to states with more opportunity. We need a teammate, a champion, who loves our state as much as we do.
I'm Matt Birk, and I am joining Dr. Scott Jensen as his lieutenant governor. I'm a son of St. Paul, raised my family here in Minnesota, and learned what it means to be a winner. I want Minnesota to be a winner, to have the best schools, the best environment for small businesses, and be the best place to raise a family. That's what Scott and I are fighting for.
Together, and with you, we're gonna lead Minnesota's comeback. It's the fourth quarter, Minnesota, and time's running out. Who do you want to have the ball?
Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Minnesota's next Lieutenant Governor, Matt Birk.
I did all my own stunts in that video. And we shot that 8 days ago, and my back still hurts. So there will be no comeback. I want to thank each and every one of you for coming here tonight to my wife's birthday party. That's what I told her we were going to do tonight. So if you could just wish her a happy birthday, that would be great, because I think she's feeling a little duped right now. Yeah. I mean, this is just a great moment for me and my family, and I'd like to thank for the state of Minnesota. And I want to thank you. I want to thank my wife, who's said yes to this adventure. I've taken her on some rides. She's a good sport about it, but thank you. We have a beautiful and strange relationship. We've been married for 20 years, and I think she's beautiful, and she thinks I'm strange. We're blessed with 8 children, 6 biological children, yeah. And 2 by the miracle of adoption. 5 of them are here tonight. And, you know, my kids are, like, for all the parents out there, you know, kids are what drive you, what inspire you, and at the end of the day, you just want your kids to be proud of you. And 5 of them are here. The other 3 had something better to do, I guess, so. I'm just kidding. They had something better to do, too, but I made them come. And I also want to thank my parents who are here somewhere. You know, thank you for taking me to church and showing me what work ethic looks like. I'm proud to say I'm from Minnesota. I'm one of us. Okay, I'm very proud of Minnesota. Minnesota has had a lot to do with who I am. I grew up in the 80s in St. Paul, and quite frankly, it was the best. I mean, it was the absolute best how I grew up. We ran around all around the neighborhood. We didn't lock our doors at night. If we would cause trouble, some adult would come out. They'd give us the talking to. It was a real community. It was special, and that helped equip me for my life to go on. Harvard, Vikings. By the way, that trophy I was holding there, that's a Lombardi trophy. I don't know if Vikings fans. I didn't want you to be confused. You've never seen one before. But really had a lot to do with who I am. And, you know, I'll admit, I got complacent. I wasn't involved or really paying attention that much. I was just kind of focusing on myself and my family and other things, but the last couple years, there's a lot of reason for concern. This is not the state that I love. There's been a lot of things going on. And so I don't believe in coincidences. So a little over a year ago, my wife and I were on an airplane coming back from Florida, and she went to the bathroom and she came back and she said, "Oh my gosh, Scott Jensen's on this plane." I thought, okay, and I had heard Scott Jensen's name. She was a big Scott Jensen fan. I didn't know who Scott Jensen was necessarily. And she said, "You gotta go say hi to him," which meant, you know, she wanted to meet Scott Jensen. So I said, "All right, well, which one is he?" She said, "He's the guy back there with the sweatshirt and the gray hair." It was February, coming back from Florida. I was the only guy in the plane without gray hair, okay? So we waited till we got off the plane, and I waved for him, and I went up to him. I said, "Are you Scott Jensen?" He said, "Yes." And I said, "I'm Matt Birk." He said, "Are you running for governor?" I said, "No." "Are you?" And he said, "Yes, I am." I said, "Well, we'd like to help." And I didn't know Scott Jensen, but I knew this. I knew that at that time, he was out there speaking the truth, taking arrows, standing up for all of us. He was showing courage. And I could relate to that a little bit. We've all had to do courageous things in our lives. I could relate to that. You know, back in 2012, I wrote a couple op-eds on the marriage amendment here in Minnesota and in Maryland that year. I took a stand. I took some arrows. In 2013, when we won the Super Bowl, did I mention that? We won the Super Bowl? We won the Super Bowl. I was invited to the White House. I declined the invitation to the White House because then President Obama addressed, was the first sitting president to address Planned Parenthood, and he said, at the end of his speech, he said, God bless Planned Parenthood. Nope. Nope. So I can go to the White House. And I took some arrows for that too. But I respected Scott because he was showing the courage to stand up and speak the truth. And I knew that he was risking a lot personally to do that. So I wanted to help him. And got to know Scott a little bit and went to a couple of events. And they're like this. Every event I went to, it was like this. Scott was packing them in. And most of the people I met at these events, they were like me. They had never been to anything like this in their lives. But they had reached a point where they didn't like where Minnesota was at, and they knew that they had to get involved as well. And I witnessed, this was a true grassroots organic movement that was happening. And I think this is how it's supposed to work. I think this is how it's supposed to work in our system, where somebody is a high-functioning individual, you know, they establish themselves in their career, they become a leader in their community, and then somebody says, hey, you should run for office. And they say, I don't know, and then they run for office, and they help lead our state. I think that's how it's supposed to happen. It's not supposed to be somebody who flounders around and is mediocre in a couple different careers, or, you know, right out of college gets into politics and embeds themselves in the underbelly of the system. I think that's the problem. That's why it's not working. And I don't care where you are politically, anywhere on the spectrum. I think we can all agree that one of the problems with politics are politicians. I am not interested in politicians. I'm interested in somebody who's a leader, who has character, and who has good Christian values. That's what I'm interested in. And everywhere I go, people ask me, oh, I see you're supporting Scott Jensen. Why are you supporting Scott Jensen? Because he's a good Christian man, because he's doing it for the right reasons, and he's the only conservative candidate that can win. That's it. Oh, for the last 26, okay? We need to do something different. And Scott is that guy. We know the issues. Education, all right? Education played a big part in my life. A huge part of my life. You know, I wouldn't have continued my football career had I not been given a great education as a child. People ask me all the time, why didn't you go to the University of Minnesota? I said, because I wasn't good enough. They didn't want me. It's true. They didn't want me, right? I wouldn't have continued my football career unless someplace like Harvard wanted me. Did anybody know? Harvard does have a football team. It's true. We got uniforms and everything. It's great. It's fun. All right. Education, and there's a lot of things that need to be fixed, but one is just the whole approach. One size does not fit all in education. One size fits one. Our families need to have choices for where their kids need to go to school. And we need different types of schools for different types of kids. And I think what we're asking teachers to do nowadays, it's too much, right? We live in a toxic culture, all right? You're getting students coming from a toxic culture. Some of them are stressed, some of them are depressed, some of them are exam obsessed, and all of them are social media possessed, okay? And we're asking teachers to be fathers and mothers and counselors, and they can't just teach. All right, we're asking them to do too much. We need to rethink the whole model, the entire model, put everything on the table. It's not an indictment of anybody, but we need to bring some creativity and entrepreneurial thinking to the education system because bureaucrats have ruined it. We know safety. MX, when I was a kid, I don't. Did we lock the door? I don't think we locked the door when I was a kid. I never locked the door. Everybody deserves to be safe, and the government needs to provide that fundamental right to all of its citizens. To me, safety, everybody deserves the right to life, first and foremost. The right to life. And I'm old enough to remember when the cops were the good guys and girls. I don't know how it got so twisted. But you will not have a safe community without law enforcement, okay? They are the good guys and the good gals. And I don't know what it's like to have to weapon up every single day and go out there and protect our streets. I have no idea. But we know that, unfortunately, cops don't always come home. I live right here in Mendota Heights. 7-8 years ago, Officer Scott Patrick, routine traffic shot and killed. I can't imagine what that would be like to leave your house every day. I thought playing football was dangerous. It's not that dangerous. It hurts, but it's not that dangerous. But, you know, we tell servicemen and women from the armed forces all the time, thank you for your service. I think we need to tell police officers, thank them for their service every single day. And business, listen, big corporations are great. You know, they provide a lot of jobs, but not everybody's a big corporation kind of person. I'm a small business owner. I love being a small business owner. I love creating things with other people. I love being responsible for my employees. We need to make it so small businesses can thrive here in Minnesota. There's certain things, like some things make me more upset. Like, you know, my kids don't pick up their shoes and things like that, but it really bothers me when I hear businesses move into Sioux Falls or move into Western Wisconsin because that environment is more conducive for their small business. We all know that the strength of Minnesota is its people. I mean, I go all over and people always say, oh, Minnesota, right? They say two things. Oh, it's really cold there, duh. And the second thing, they always say the people. The people are so great. You know, we've got this great moral fiber, these great values, this work ethic, a humility. We've got everything we have. We've got a great roster here in Minnesota. There's no reason why businesses should be leaving, why our best and our brightest should be leaving to go other places. We have everything we need right here. And we need to fix that. We need to fix that because when small businesses thrive, I mean, I don't know about you. I mean, like I said, big business is great. I'm not trying to demonize them, but my neighborhood, we don't need another Walgreens or another Starbucks or we just don't. We got enough, okay? We need more small businesses. They're the backbone and the heartbeat of our communities. So listen, I'm not getting into politics because I need a savior, okay? I already have one. What I'm looking for is a leader. And Scott is that guy. He has the courage, the competence, and the character to lead. And he's proven that. And I want to say this to the other Republican candidates, all right? I know you're all taking your, hey, I get it. Scott's way ahead. You're going to take your shots. Okay, I can understand that. But just stop. Stop saying Scott's not pro-life. Stop saying he's not pro-Second Amendment. And the latest one is that he's a Putin sympathizer, pro-Russia, okay? Just stop. It's beneath you. And if we all want to be leaders, if we see ourselves as leaders, let's raise the discourse around the conversation, okay? I mean, to say Scott Jensen, stands with Putin, I mean, now, Scott did confess to me when he watched Rocky IV, he was rooting for Ivan Drago, but that's as far as it went, all right? But stop it. And to Tim Walz and Peggy Flanagan, this thing got away from you. It got away from you. You had an opportunity to step up and lead. And leadership is invisible until it's not. Anybody can lead when times are good. You know, we used to call those front of the line guys in football. You know, you win a game and
Guys would be standing in the locker room. Who wants to interview me? And then next week you'd lose. We couldn't find those guys anywhere. We had to put them on a milk carton. All right? Leaders lead when times got tough. This thing got away from them. And they enacted their emergency powers. And what did they do? Instead of leading and doing what was best for the people and following the science, they played politics. They played politics, and they just did what everybody else was doing. And if there's one thing we see 2 years later, it was 100% wrong. It was 100% wrong. I'm really excited about this opportunity. I consider it an honor. And the great thing about this for me is being with Scott and Team Jensen, and it's a team effort, but being with him and the team is we're only going to be guided by doing what's best for Minnesotans. We're a little bit of a problem, all right? We're a little bit of a problem for a lot of the political folks on both sides, because we're not beholden to anybody. All right? We're not beholden to anybody. We're only going to be driven by doing the right things, the right way, for the right reasons. That's it. That's it. And I think that, we all know Minnesota can be better. I think everybody agrees we can be better. I don't want to be better. I want Minnesota to be the best. The absolute best. Why can't we be the best? Why can't we have the greatest school system in the country? Why can't we have the safest streets? Why can't we have the greatest business community? Why are we playing small? It doesn't make any sense. But here's the thing. Scott's the face of this, okay? But it's going to take every single one of us. It's going to take every single person, all right? There's no one person. Every single person has to get involved, play their role, and do whatever you feel called to do, because it's going to take every single one of us. And what's the election? 6 months away? Math is hard. 8 months away? I don't know what the parents like. Are you ready for this? I don't even really know what I'm getting into. I really don't, to tell you the truth. But I know this. I know how to grind. I know how to grind day after day after day after day. And I know what it's like to be on a team. And sometimes when you're grinding, you get tired, you get worn out, you get beat up. That's what teammates are for, all right? That's what teammates are for. Scott is going to become the next governor of this state because of all of us. So we're just getting started. We're just getting started, and I can't wait for the opposition to come. I can't wait for the arrows. I love it. You know what? Because when you encounter resistance, I think that means that you're doing something right. And we're doing something right here, people. So keep showing up. Thank you very much. God bless you.